Good morning. Good morning. I said, what a beautiful sound this is. We've missed it for a long time to hear you greeting one another as you're coming together for worship. That's blessed me already before the service has even begun, just to see you visiting with one another and meeting with one another. Welcome to those of you who are in the building. Welcome to those who are joining us by YouTube. And together through the Holy Spirit, we know that we are one through this whole time, more than a year. God has kept us together, although we've not been physically together. He's kept us together through His Spirit. But what a joy it is to be able to be here with you. We welcome you to the service. I think that you know in regards to the masks that there is not a requirement. They are recommended for those who are not fully vaccinated. Once again, welcome. And as we come with open hearts and open spirits, we know that God is going to visit with us. He's already here. He's here in you through His Holy Spirit. So when we come together as His people, He certainly comes with us. He's here. He's ministering to us. He's speaking into our hearts and into our lives. And I know that we're going to go from this place enthused and strengthened, encouraged in our walk with the Lord. Let me pray and ask God's blessing upon our meeting. Our dear God and Father, thank you for this opportunity, this privilege to come together, whether it's in person in this building or through the internet today or throughout this week or in future weeks. Father, we are joined together by your Spirit. Father, you minister in us and through us. And Lord, I pray that in this service we will glorify and exalt you, because you've said that if you will be lifted up, all men, all people will be drawn to you. And we want to be drawn to you. Be glorified in this time. Bless us, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning. I'll begin with a reading from Psalm 139. It says this: You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your Spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. And then he says this: How precious to me are your thoughts, God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of sand. When I awake, I am still with you. Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. Amen. Lord, we thank you that you know us so deeply, and wherever we are, wherever we go, we are never too far from you. You are with us. And we thank you that whatever we go through, we can always trust that you are with us, and you not only give us your presence through your Spirit, but you give us one another to go through this. Help us to know today that we are not alone. In Jesus' name.
If you are lonely, when you feel afraid, you're not the only We are all the same, in need of mercy, to be forgiven and free. It's all you've got to lean on, but thank God it's all you need. And all the people said amen. Oh, 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 all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for His love never ends. And all the people said amen. If you're rich or poor, well, it don't matter. Weak or strong, you know love is what we're after. We're all broken, but we're all in this together. God knows we stumble and fall. So loved the world, He sent His Son to save us all. And all the people said amen. Whoa, whoa, whoa. All the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for His love never ends. And all the people said amen. Blessed are the poor in spirit, who are torn apart. Blessed are the persecuted and the pure in heart. Blessed are the people hungry for another start. For this is the kingdom of God. And all the people said amen. Whoa, whoa, whoa. All the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord for His love. Said amen. All the people said amen. And all the people said amen. Whoa, whoa, whoa. All the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for His love never ends. And all the people said amen. And all the people said amen. Thou my vision, O Lord of my heart. Not be all else to me, save that Thou art. Thou my best thought, by day or by night. Waking or sleeping, Thy presence my light. Thou my wisdom, and Thou my true word. I ever with Thee, and Thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, I Thy true Son. Thou in me dwelling, and I with Thee one. Riches I need not, nor man's empty praise. Thou my inheritance, now and always. Thou and Thou only, first in my heart. My King of heaven, my treasure Thou art. King of heaven, my victory won. May I reach heaven's joys, bright heaven's sun. Heart of my own heart, whatever befall, still be my vision. Oh, all else to me,
So good to hear the singing fill this room. That's what we've been missing for months. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that He should give His only Son to make a wretch His treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the Father turns His face away, as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold the man upon a cross, my sin upon His shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice call out among the scoffers. It was my sin that held Him there until it was a dying breath has brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. How should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer, but this I know with all my heart, His wounds have paid my
my name. He knows my name.
mercy hears me when I call.
Lord, we thank you that you are such a good Father. Lord, you know what we need even before we ask. Lord, you know us better than we know ourselves. You know how to fill those empty places, those longings, those things that can only be fulfilled by you. We pray that you would meet with us. You would show us your goodness, and that we would have the faith to taste and see that you are good, and to know your presence, your abundance, your provision, your promise, and your fulfillment in our hearts and in our lives today. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we ask. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. It's so nice to see your lovely faces out there on this beautiful, sunshiny day. But I have a question for you. How many of you remembered to bring your umbrella the last time it rained? Well, you know, for me, it seems that whenever I go outside, I always forget to take an umbrella. And the crazy part about it is I know it rains here. So without an umbrella, guess what? Oh, that's right, Danielle. I get wet. Yes. Well, I brought a few umbrellas with me today to help us think about shelter and protection. I brought this particular umbrella with me today because it is large, right? And not only will it keep me from getting wet, but it also will keep me from getting sunburned at the beach. It will also protect me from, actually, the snow in the wintertime. Well, and then I have this medium-sized one that I could possibly share with someone who has forgotten their umbrella. That would be nice to do as well, especially when we unexpectedly get rain. But you know what? You can also carry this little small one. You can keep it in your car. You can put it in your backpack when you go to school or if you go to the park, so that you will always have one available to you. In Psalms chapter 61 and verse 4, it says, "Let me live in your holy tent forever and find safety in the shelter of your ways." You know, this verse compares God's care and protection to being under a tent. But you know, an umbrella is kind of like a tent, but you can take it with you wherever you go. And no matter how hard it rains, you are warm and safe under God's umbrella. Wherever we go, or no matter what happens, we know we are safe under the umbrella of God's care. We can think of God's love in so many different ways, but one of the ways we can think of it, as my pages are stuck together, that an umbrella is sheltering you from the rains all about you, and he will always, always keep you in his care. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your umbrella of care that stands over us as you love us day in and day out. Bless us in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Roger, worship team, for bringing us so powerfully into God's presence through those well-chosen songs that are sung from the heart. They're not just music, are they? But they're an expression of what we believe and what we experience in Christ. And thank you, Sheila, for reminding us about the umbrella. I always say the way to be sure it doesn't rain is bring your umbrella, right? So it can work the other way as well. God is looking over us. This would be the time in our service when we receive our offering, and we're doing it just a bit differently at the present time. For those of you who are in the building, there is a box at the back where you can drop your offering, and then, of course, you can continue to give through e-transfer, mail it in, drop it through the mail slot, and thank you for your continued support of this church, because when you're supporting this church, you're supporting the gospel around the world as we work with churches through our convention, through Canadian Baptist Ministries. The gospel is going out because of you. Let's ask God's blessing on the offering. Dear Father, we thank you for your many blessings. Father, we thank you for the greatest blessing of all, the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, that someone, maybe many people, told us the gospel, shared the gospel with us. But Father, we know that for this to happen, it needs to happen in a way that will produce results and be effective for you. We need the support and encouragement of all brothers and sisters. Bless this offering, we pray, in Jesus' name, amen. And as we come to our pastoral prayer, I know there are many concerns and burdens and requests upon your heart. You know that you can always share it with me through our prayer team email. And on Wednesday, as we come together for our prayer meeting, your prayer requests are lifted up. As we pray this morning, I specifically want us to think about praying for our church and for all churches as we're kind of restarting, coming back to this new normal, this things being the same and yet different. We've got to find our way forward. And I believe that God not only wants us to come back to normal, he wants us to become even better and stronger and more effective and flourish in our faith and our service. So I'm going to pray for our church. I know you're praying for your church, for your staff and leaders, counselors, and each member, and for the church around the world. Let us pray. Our dear God and Father, we thank you for the gift of your church. Lord, we're reminded that the very first Christians, even with no other history, sensed the need to come together. And for 2,000 years, that has been the desire of your people to meet in groups of 2 and 3, or 2 and 3,000, or 20 and 30,000, to meet, Lord, in many different places, in many different languages and cultural settings, but to come together around the name of Jesus Christ. Lord, bless your church. Help us, Father, who are members of your church, to receive the responsibility to care for it, because the church is only healthy as we are individually healthy believers. Father, bless us here at Burnaby North. Lord, help us to work together in unity in the power of your Spirit. Help us to be found as faithful witnesses for you in this community in which you've placed us. Father, we pray for our sister churches in this convention and churches, Lord, around the world today that are proclaiming the name of Christ. Bless your people. Help us to be faithful and bold. Help us, Lord, to stand strong in you. We're aware, Lord, that there are brothers and sisters today in the world who are suffering persecution for their faith. Lord, bless and encourage them. And Father, for those of us who have freedom, help us to not take it for granted, but to use it for your glory and the good of your kingdom around the world. Lord, now be with us as we approach your word. Open it to us. Prepare our hearts and our spirits for these moments together. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. Amen. I want to begin this morning our sermon, as I often do, with a question. A question that should encourage some thinking. Is your faith childish or childlike? Is your faith, now by faith I mean, is your relationship with and understanding of God, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit, is your walk in the faith childish or childlike? I'm sure you would agree with me, there's a big difference between a childish faith and a childlike faith. You may know that the Apostle Paul, among others, repeatedly admonishes us as disciples of Christ to grow up, to grow up. He himself, in 1 Corinthians 13, and verse 11, said, "When I was a child, I talked like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child. But when I became a man, I put the ways of childhood behind me." Spiritually, grow up. In his letter to the Ephesians in Ephesians 4, Paul challenges us to be mature in the Lord, measuring up to the full and complete standard of Christ, so that we will no longer be immature like children, that we won't be tossed back and forth by every wind of new teaching. So Paul makes it clear, your faith should not be childish. Grow up. And Jesus makes it clear that our faith should be childlike. He famously said in Luke 18, verses 16 and 17, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. Truly I tell you, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it." Let me read that again. "Anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it." Jesus is not recommending childish faith, but he is recommending childlike faith. What's the difference? Clearly there's a significant difference. What's the difference? We need to know the difference because it has serious consequences for our faith, for our experience, for our service, for our walk with the Lord. What is the difference? Well, I want to share with you five thoughts about the difference between childish and childlike faith. And I want to start out by saying these thoughts, these points, are not original with me. I actually came upon them probably 25 years ago. And somehow they've stuck with me through the years. They keep coming back into my mind and my heart. And for the sake of preaching it, I tried to find the original author, and I was not able to do that. But I think it makes some good points. For example, a childish faith says good Christians don't have problems and disappointments. A childlike faith says God uses our problems and disappointments to deepen our faith. I'm sure you can immediately see the difference there, right? If you think that being good and believing in God will make life a bed of roses, I don't think I need to say this. You are seriously mistaken. You're setting yourself up for grave disappointment. Now, we believe this morning in an almighty and eternal God. Jesus tells us that because we're born again by faith in him as our Savior, our citizenship is in heaven. But the practical truth is, for now, we must live in this present, real, and deeply scarred world. There is no hint in God's word that believers will be spared trouble. Indeed, I would suggest it's exactly the opposite. A case can be made that much of the Bible is written as comfort for troubled souls. And if there was any argument about it, Jesus put it to rest when he said in John 16:33, "In this world you will have trouble." And he was talking to believers, to disciples. In this world, you will have trouble. If you look that up in the context, he is specifically talking about radical discipleship. He is saying to his disciples, if you get serious about living for me, guess what? Trouble is going to come. Because there's a case that could be made that it may even be harder to live in this world because we are disciples of Jesus Christ. This truth, this fact, flies in the face of modern prosperity gospel that you're hearing on your televisions or listening to online, except for this service, of course. You know, you're hearing, just believe, send us some money, and it'll all be great. I know you're not falling for that. It's not what the Bible says in any way. Because we live under God's wings, because He has a purpose for our lives, God redeems our troubles. He redeems our troubles as we face our troubles, our faith is deepened and we're drawn closer to Him. No doubt you're pretty familiar with the old story, the Old Testament story of Job. A man who we're told was blameless and upright. He feared God. He shunned evil. And yet few have been more tried than Job. But in the midst of his troubles, Job could declare, "But God knows the way that I take, and when He has tested me, I will come forth as gold. Though I suffer," Job said, "I know that God is with me, and I know that God is using this time, not causing it necessarily, but using it to purify me, to burn off the dross of sin and faithlessness, that I might draw closer to Him and stronger in my faith." A childish faith says good Christians don't have problems and disappointments. A childlike faith says God uses our problems and our disappointments to deepen our faith. A childish faith says God always gives me what I want. A childlike faith says God sometimes says no. Is it true that God always answers our prayers, that God always gives us what we want? In John chapter 15 and verse 7, it seems like Jesus is suggesting that. He said to His disciples, "If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you." So is Jesus really saying, ask for whatever you want and you'll get it? Somehow we all know that can't be what He's saying, right? Clearly He's not saying that. We know that from practical reality. We simply know in our own experience and the experience of others that many sincere and rightful prayers seem to, as far as we can tell, go unanswered. So that's our practical reality, isn't it? And of course, if we go back to what Jesus said, we must note that there's a condition there. He said, "If you remain in me, and if my words remain in you." Now let's be clear. Jesus is not setting up a reward system where your prayers are answered according to how much faith you have, as though faith is a commodity instead of a quality. Jesus is not suggesting that the likelihood of answered prayer depends level of sincerity, your goodness, or your holiness. In this statement, Jesus is referring to a quality of relationship. You see, faith isn't just about believing. When you understand faith from the Bible, we saw a few weeks ago that Jesus said even Satan believes, right? Faith isn't about believing. Faith is about a relationship. It's about knowing. It's about experiencing. And so Jesus is talking about an experience here, a relationship. If you're in me and I am in you, ask whatever you will and it will be answered. How can He say that? What He's saying is this. If you are truly filled with me and you're truly walking with me, your prayers will always be in my will and to my purpose. And it is those prayers that I will indeed answer. So we pursue, and we've talked about this many times, we pursue when we pray, not the prayer, but the relationship. Not the prayer, but the relationship. However, it might be accurate to say that God does always answer our prayers, but sometimes the answer is no. That's right. Bill Hybel said, "Sometimes what seems being an answered prayer is actually a clearly answered prayer. It's just that the answer is no. Our God loves us," I love this, "our God loves us too much to say yes to every request. Let me say that again. Our God loves us too much to say yes to every request. Sometimes God says no. And if our faith is childish, we'll throw a tantrum, right? And we'll hound God as though somehow we can wear him down. That's what a child does. But if our faith is childlike, we will trust our Father's wisdom and we'll rest in him. A childish faith says, God always gives me what I want. A childlike faith says, God sometimes says no. A childish faith says, God wants to make me happy. A childlike faith says, God wants to make me holy. Many consider God a killjoy, someone who just sucks all the fun out of life. And so we ask ourselves sometimes, to be holy, do I have to be unhappy? Do the two go together? Well, it's very clear that God wants us to be holy. The scriptures are clear on that. I probably don't need to read many of them to you, but remember what Peter said in quoting the Old Testament? As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance, but just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do, for it is written, because I am holy, be holy because I am holy. Or Paul, who said in 1 Thessalonians 3:13, may he strengthen your hearts so that you will be blameless and holy in the presence of our God and Father when our Lord Jesus Christ comes with all his holy ones. So it's clear that God wants us to be holy. He wants us to be holy. I spent many years, and maybe you did too, running from that concept of holiness. It frightened me because I thought holiness meant moral perfection. And guess what? I was out of luck if it was that, right? But somehow by God's grace, I came to see that that's not actually the definition of holiness. The biblical term for holiness, both in the Hebrew and the Greek languages, literally means to be set apart to a special purpose, to be consecrated, to be sacred. Holiness then, from as far as God is concerned, is not so much about poor moral perfection, as it is about a condition of the heart and the spirit that only comes from our holy God. It is a result of an intimate and growing relationship with God, a relationship that leads us to something better, something more robust than happiness. And it's joy. It's joy. Jesus said in John 15, if you keep my commandments, you will remain in my love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. A childish faith says, God wants to make me happy. A childlike faith says, God wants to make me holy. Because we understand that holiness leads us to something better than happiness. It leads us to joy. A childish faith says, faith will help me to understand what God is doing in my life and in my world. A childlike faith says, I will have faith in God even when I don't understand what he is doing. Now let me be clear here as well. Faith is not willful ignorance, right? Faith in God will open our hearts and open our minds to know God and to know his word and to know his will. But I think we all know that there's a severe limit on that knowledge. It's limited by our finite humanness and God's infinite divinity. So there's only so much that we can know now about him. God summed it up this way in Isaiah 55. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. The depth and the maturity of our faith is proven when we trust and rest in God when we do not know what he is doing. Having faith in God at these times means that we trust in his character. This kind of faith, this kind of trust is only possible when we know God and when we have a personal relationship with him based in truth and experience. Simply said, we only trust those we know, right? We only trust those we know. And the reason I've come to see that many people struggle to trust God is because they don't really know him. I mean, really know him from his word, really know him through his spirit. They may think they do, but to know him from his word, to know him by his spirit, is to trust him. Many years ago, I was introduced to a song entitled Trust His Heart. And this is the words of the chorus of that song. It stuck with me through the years. It says, God is too wise to be mistaken. God is too good to be unkind. So when you don't understand, when you don't see his plan, when you can't trace his hand, trust his heart. So much of life comes down to that. And if you're convinced that if you just dig deep enough in the Bible and you just pray hard enough, you're going to find an answer and an explanation for everything, you're going to be disappointed. But when you study the Bible and pray and seek God's face, when you don't understand, you'll still have peace because you'll know that God knows. A childish faith says faith will help me understand what God is doing in my life and the world. A childlike faith says, I will have faith in God even when I don't understand what he is doing. And finally, a childish faith says, good Christians are always strong. A childlike faith says, our strength is in admitting our weakness to God. We can probably all relate with a story in Mark chapter 9 of the father of the demon-possessed boy. He came to Jesus, obviously seeking healing for his son. And Jesus challenged him, do you believe, do you really believe I can do this? You remember his reply in Mark 9 and 24? He said, I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. I do believe. Help me overcome my unbelief. We want to have a strong faith. And we know that Jesus wants us to have a strong faith. But the reality is that sometimes we struggle to have that deep and powerful faith we desire. In these times when our faith is beginning to wane and we're struggling, instead of putting on a face of false bravado, let us learn that our greatest strength is to freely admit to our weakness. This was one of the most important lessons that the Apostle Paul learned early in his ministry. The Apostle Paul, we would think of him as a type A personality, somebody who could do, somebody who could get it done, somebody who just took the bull by the horns and went out there and won. And someone like that struggles when they can't always get it done, right? We're told in 2 Corinthians chapter 12 that Paul confesses there that he was afflicted with a thorn in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment him. Now, we don't know the exact nature of that affliction, but it seems like it was some type of physical ailment which dogged his steps and held him back from doing all that he longed to do in the service of the Lord. Paul tells us that three times he pleaded with God to take it away. But then in prayer, and I'm going to guess in confusion and brokenness, he heard God say, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." And then Paul could declare, "For when I am weak, then I am strong." For when I am weak, then I am strong. When we are able and willing to admit to our weaknesses, we will turn to God for strength that we need to grow in our faith. strength to trust him in our failures, strength to be filled with his power. And then we can proclaim with the Apostle Paul, I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. A childish faith says, good Christians are always strong. A childlike faith says, our strength is in admitting our weakness to God. Is your faith childish or childlike? Maybe the reason I've gone back to this through the years is because every once in a while we need to ask ourselves that question, every one of us. Is my faith childish or is it childlike? Because Jesus was pretty clear when he said, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it. Let us pray. Our dear God, we confess that sometimes our faith has been childish, not pleasing to you or us, not helpful, not powerful, not effective. Dear God, as we close this service, we pray that you will fill us with a childlike faith, a faith that trusts, a faith that rests, a faith that realizes that the power to live and to serve is in you, through us, and in us. Fill us with this faith that we might be your servants. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
We can look to the example of Jesus, what a childlike faith looks like. He always trusted in his Father, and he said, let your will, not mine, be done.
Help me seek your kingdom first. As Jesus walked, so shall I walk, held by your same unchanging love. Be still my soul, oh, lift your voice and pray, Father, not my will but yours be done. How in the garden persisted, I may never fully know the fearful weight of true obedience. It was held by him alone. What wondrous faith to bear that cross, to bear my sin. What wondrous love, be smiled. There my Savior prayed, Father, not my will, but yours be done. When I am lost, when I am broken, in the night of fear and doubt, still I will trust in my good Father. Yes, to one great King I bow. As Jesus rose, so shall I rise in ransom glory at the throne. My heart restored me. All your saints I pray, Father, not my will but yours be done. As we go forth, our God and Father, lead us daily in the fight, that all the world might see your glory and your name be lifted high. And in this name we overcome, for you shall see us safely home. Now as your church, lift our voice and pray, Father, not my will, but yours be done. Father, not my will, but yours be done. Father, not my will, but yours be done.
Amen. And that prayer of our Savior is our prayer, a childlike prayer. Father, not my will, but thine be done. Thank you so much for coming together. I want to remind you of our Saturday meetup at the park. It's going to be at Confederation Park. Notice it's going to be at 10 in the morning. We were saying 2, but we decided we start just a little earlier in the day. And you got an email from me, you should have, with more information. If you have any questions, you can contact myself or Roger or Sandra. And there'll just be an informal time to get together, to encourage one another, to bless one another in this beautiful time of the year. Let me ask God's blessing on us as we go. Our dear God and Father, we thank you for your love. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for salvation. We thank you for your Holy Spirit. We thank you for your living word. And we thank you, Lord, for our brothers and sisters in Christ. Father, we ask now for your blessings upon us as we go from this time and place, as we go out into our week, that, Lord, we will surrender to you and lean on you and be filled with you in every situation we face, that we might bring glory to you and be a witness to your love. Guide our steps, protect and keep us. We ask these things in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you.